Hello students of Dynamics, this is Dr. Dan Baker, and in today's video we're going to talk about work and energy. But to put work and energy into a bit of a framework and a bit of a context, let's take a look at the various types of particle kinetics tools, some which we've covered so far in class and a couple that we have left to go. Okay, so back in chapter 13 out of the Hibbler textbook, we covered Newtonian particle kinetics. The key thing here is that the Newtonian approach is an acceleration-based approach, which then relates basically the forces to acceleration. Everything else, velocities and displacements and time, while they can be used to solve for the acceleration, everything's still focused on the acceleration. Okay, and then as we got into chapter 14, the first topic we covered was conservation of energy. And the reason we start with conservation of energy is it's likely the most familiar topic to you. And one nice thing about energy is a velocity-based technique, being a velocity-based technique based upon kinetic energy. And it's also a displacement-based technique. And we're going to talk more about that today. And then it still can include forces. It's just that for conservation, they have to be these conservative forces. Conservative forces basically being exchanged between particles or between components of the system, not any external forces. And so today we'll be able to include these external forces as we get into basically this term right here, which is the for all forces, we can look at work energy. So this is today's focus. And then in some later videos at the end of the chapter, we'll get into impulse momentum. So notice that work energy can have a lot of strong parallels to conservation. Fundamentally, we're just going to add in a work term. So in looking at work and energy, we've kind of talked probably all that we're going to in a very general sense about the energy terms. We spent a full lecture on those. So let's focus here on work. Now I'll use the variable W for work, and this is defined as the amount of energy transferred to a particle. So we can see even in this definition, right, embedded right in here, is that work and energy are inextricably linked. Okay, it turns out that work and energy have the same units. Work and energy can have a sign difference because typically we look at either the work that's happening on a particle or the energy that's being stored in a system. And I'll highlight some of those as we move forward. But just this idea that work and energy in your mind, you can think, oh, they're the same thing generally. They just have a little bit different framework. And so one way that we can find this amount of energy transferred to a particle is using an equation, and that's looking at the work between position 1 to position 2 is equal to an integral of our force vector, and you can think this is like the sum of all forces, because you can actually do it with multiple forces. We're going to dot that with dr, okay, so where dr is our displacement. Now, if we have a constant force, the force does not change in magnitude or direction, then we can actually treat this as simply just a dot product, and that is going to dot f, and here we'll put sum of f dotted with R. Okay, so this is our fundamental equations, and I'll put a couple notes with these. The one here with the integral is for a variable force. So a force that changes with position, and then over on the right here, this is with a constant force. So let's go ahead and draw a little sketch about what this might look like. So let's say that we have a path, something like this, and we have a particle that starts over here. It's going to finish over at this point. So we'll call this 1, call this over here 2. And again, this is the path of that particle. And so it turns out there's a couple different ways that we can look at work. And they're, of course, both going to be related to a force. And I'm going to draw the force here as being horizontal. So here is our force. Now, you could either write this for the overall displacement r or for dr. Let's go ahead, I'll write this for the overall displacement r. Okay, so there's my force, there is my displacement, and let's take a look at these various terms. And so as we think about work, we'll say that work is, now work can be defined as two different things. One of those, so we'll say A, work is a scalar value with its positive or negative sign from F dotted with R. Right. Remember that with a dot product, if your vectors are in the same direction, you get a positive sign. If they're in generally opposite directions, you get a negative sign. So just a little highlight of that here. So we get a positive if F is in direction of R vector, and we get a negative sign if F is opposite R. Okay, so same thing we had from our previous dot product experience. And then as we think about what this dot product is actually doing, so this is gonna be part B. I'm gonna move it over here to the left a little bit just so I have a little bit more room. So we can say this is gonna be the product of either. Okay, so this is a bit of a choose your own adventure. It's going to be a little 2x2 table. So product of either the top left cell is going to be the force component parallel, these two vertical lines are parallel to the full displacement and then the second row here, we could say the full force and the displacement parallel to the force. So this top row, we could write this as W from 1 to 2 is equal to, now I'll use some color coding here, we'll go with all my forces in red, so F sub T, that is a vector, and we're going to dot that with the full vector R, and then the second one here is that equivalent, still work from 1 to 2, but this is going to be my full vector F. And we're going to dot this with what I'm going to call R, which is parallel to F. Okay, so I'll write all these vectors on my drawing. So zoom there a touch. So if we look at tangential, we know that our tangential component, right, F sub T, is going to be tangential to that curve, noting that we could have another component F sub N. Turns out this normal force, F sub N, won't do any work because it's perpendicular to that displacement. And so this basically shows our F sub T and that R vector are in line with one another. Okay, so that's this line right here, just dotting F sub T and my R. So the other option is to essentially use the full force but then use the component of the displacement. Okay, here's that R, which is parallel to F. Noting that I could also break this into components, and I could say that this one is R, which is perpendicular to F. Okay, once again, creating a parallelogram there, which are components of the overall vector R. And so this pair of vectors gives me this line right here, right, which is composed of the total force F and the portion of R, which is parallel to F. And so another way that I can frame these two different approaches is that the first approach, which typically is probably the more obvious one, the one most people's brains jump to, this is the particle-based approach. And so as you draw a free body diagram, you're likely to think more about that tangential force and then the full displacement of R. And I think about this next one here as more of a system-based approach. Now, our example, which will be in the video following this one, will actually be one of these system-based approach problems. Now, I'll show you can solve it either way, but there certainly are some problems where it's much easier to take a system-based approach versus a particle-based approach, essentially looking at the displacement of the force versus the amount of force in the direction of the displacement. Okay? So all of this material on work so far has been true for any force on a particle. Okay, so say that we have a hypothetical particle here and that it is, and we'll actually use the same path. So I'm assuming here at one. And so at one, we would end up with not only a normal force. Let's assume this is a vertical, so we'll show kind of all the possible forces. So this path is in a vertical plane. So if it's in a vertical plane, we also need to include a weight force. We could even include, I didn't draw it in this picture here, but let's just assume we have a horizontal spring force, okay, pulling it along that path. So there's our normal, our spring force, our weight force, and then we apply it over here, our external force, F, right? So this we would consider our external. And basically external in that it's not coming from weight, it's not coming from springs, it's just applied from the outside, right? So those are the ones that we're gonna focus on here in this section. And so as we take a look at this free body diagram, we want to determine which of these forces we need to worry about the work and which we don't. Okay, so going through these one by one, it turns out that for our spring force is already an energy term. So if we leave it as an energy term, we don't need to compute the work of a spring force. Same thing with our weight force. Our weight force is gravitational potential energy. So if we include it as a weight term, don't include it as a work term. Our normal force is perpendicular to motion, okay? So if you have perpendicular to motion, then the dot product of that normal force with our displacement vector R is going to be zero. So the only force we have left that we really need to worry about our work is this external term. So in that context, let's say that we are assuming you leave spring and gravitational potential energy as energy terms, We are left with, we're going to call W prime from 1 to 2. Okay, so not all work terms, but it's going to turn out to be only the external work terms. Okay, so this is the work between 1 to 2 of all external forces. So when I say external, once again, it will ignore spring forces. It will ignore weight forces. Now, technically, just to be kind of complete and robust, you probably should think at least, consider the fact, if there is a normal force, if it could do work or not. Most of the time they won't, okay? Because most of the time these normal forces are perpendicular to the displacement. But there are some cases that you might need to include that. And so if we redefine this external work term, we can combine this into our energy term, 1/2 mv1 squared. There's our kinetic energy. Gravitational potential is mgh1. Then we have our spring energy, 1/2 k delta 1 squared. Now here's that new term, plus W prime from 1 to 2. Okay, here's the new kid on the block. And it's essentially just adding in more energy on the left side of this equation. The work term can be positive. It also can be negative. If you have a force which is opposing motion, you're actually taking energy away from your system, okay? So it's still going to mean on the left side, it would just show up on the left side as a negative value. And then the right side looks just the same as it did before. Kinetic energy, 1/2 mv2 squared. Gravitational potential, mgh2. And spring, 1/2 k delta 2 squared. Okay, so there is our new and improved work and energy equation. Okay, and here's the new term which we added. Everything else is exactly the same it was for conservation of energy. Just to helpfully reinforce my statement before, the units are exactly the same. Let's consider the units of work and the units of kinetic energy. Okay, so kinetic energy, 1/2 mv1 squared. If we look at the units of kinetic energy, of course the 1/2 doesn't have any units. Mass, let's assume we're in SI system, so we have kilograms. And then for our velocity, we're going to square meters per second. Okay, so you square the top, you square the bottom. So kilogram meter squared divided by second squared. So if we rearrange things here a little bit, we can cluster together the kilogram meters per second squared. And that leaves me a meter. Okay, and I think you'll probably remember that a kilogram meter per second squared, this is the same thing as a newton. And essentially, we have a newton times a meter, which is the same thing that we would compute if we took the sum of our forces as a vector and dotted those with R. Okay, so that just basically proves that for kinetic energy and our work term, that we're talking about the same stuff, right? The units are exactly the same, whether we're talking about energy or work. Hopefully this was a good review, not only of conservation of energy, at least in a brief sense, but also getting you to think more about what is work and how do we compute it, and can we compute it in different ways? The answer is yes. Fundamentally, it's all based upon a dot product. It's all based upon this F dot R, but we can take different components of both F and R, whether we take a particle-based approach or a system-based approach. Thank you again for your attention today. Hope you're having a great day.